It's the biggest crowd pleaser on Main Street, USA. It's the Disneyland Band. Originally hired for a 2-week contract, 65 years later, it is still part of Disneyland's daily entertainment. Tonight, we meet a man who spent 47 years making sure we're thoroughly entertained at one of our favorite amusement parks. It's good to have you here.
From Los Angeles, this is KLCS PBS. Welcome to Everybody with Angela Williamson, an innovation, arts, education, and public affairs program. Everybody with Angela Williamson is made possible by viewers like you. Thank you. And now your host, Dr. Angela Williamson.
Stan Freese is our guest. Stan, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me. This is fun.
You know, there's so much we want to cover tonight, but before we get into all the other, what you call in your book, mayhem, future book, let's talk a little bit about you. Tell us about that dare in fourth grade.
Oh, well, yeah, 1954. Oh man, I'm old, geez Louise. Yeah, I was 9 years old and we were in the auditorium at Wooddale School in Edina, Minnesota. And the band director came on stage with a bunch of different instruments and we were to pick out the instrument that we wanted to play. And so I had remembered as a kid, my dad was a band leader at a high school band, and when I was little, the guys used to stick me in the sousaphone and walk around the, you know, with me in the horn. And so I kind of remembered that. So I went, you know what? I think I'm going to take that. A friend of mine dared me, gave me Keith Critchlow and Bruce McFadden, and each gave me a quarter. And so back in 1954, that was good. And so the rest is history. I took the tuba and my parents figured, okay, this is great. He'll only take it for a couple of weeks anyhow. He's got to get tired of that big thing. Well, I didn't, so.
And you took the tuba for all over the world, correct?
All over the world, yeah. Some places it shouldn't have been, as you can well imagine.
Well, I want to talk about some of those places that we can do right now on educational TV.
Okay, I gotcha.
And first of all, I want to talk about how does a fourth grader who decides to choose a tuba as a dare, how do you get from Minnesota to Walt Disney Company? So take us on that story.
Well, quickly, my father, like I say, was a public school teacher and a trumpet player. And so when I brought that tuba home, he went down to the music store and bought trumpet solos for me, not telling me that you shouldn't be able to play those on a tuba. So immediately in fourth grade, I was learning, my dad would give me a lesson every night, I was learning trumpet solos, easy ones on the tuba. And by the time I was in fifth grade, I won the high school tuba championship, state championship, and just because I didn't know you weren't supposed to be able to do that. And then one thing led to another, started doing a little act, got on the Welk show, blah, blah, blah.
I love how you just sum that up, blah, blah,
yeah,
blah.
Yeah.
But there's more to this blah, 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 because you have been all over. You've toured the world. And so my question for you is, tell me what has been your most memorable moment with that tuba on educational TV, remember?
Oh, yeah, that's right. Well, I can't think of anything. No. I did play, however, at a place called the Roaring Twenties. Behind Sally Rand, tuba in a little band, the burlesque dancer with the fans, the fan dancer. So nothing like playing behind her. So, but before that, I was a soloist at the University of Minnesota, and the Minister of Culture from Moscow had come to the United States to select a group to reopen the cultural exchange program between the United States and the Soviet Union that would to go to the Soviet Union for a 2-month tour all through that Soviet Union, Siberia. So anyhow, so they ended up choosing the University of Minnesota Wind Ensemble if I would be the tuba soloist. So I said, yeah, you know, that'd be cool. So then that got enough notoriety in the Soviet Union because they'd never had a tuba soloist before. So I was on billboards and everything. It was so crazy. And so Nixon got word of that. And so we got an invitation before we even came back to the States. He wanted us to come, and he wanted me to do a command performance in the Rose Garden of the White House. And that day in the United States, there was no other news. No dog got run over, nothing. And so this was on the front page of all these major newspapers. And Disney happened to see that. And so there was a fellow by the name of Jim Christensen and Bob Yanni at Disney. And they got a hold of me and said, would you be interested in coming down to Walt Disney World? We're going to open that next year as a tuba player. And I said, sure. And we engaged in conversation and blah, blah, blah. And the next thing you know, they said, would you like to be the leader of the Disney World Band? I said, sure. So away we went down to Florida, and I did that for 2 years. Got tired of alligators and bugs and came out to California and led the Disneyland Band for a number of years.
And so when you were in Florida and they're telling you there's going to be another amusement park in Anaheim, you jumped.
Well, there already was Disneyland. Yeah, this was 71. So, yeah, so they said, well, I had kind of given notice because, you know.
You didn't like alligators?
Well, no. Well, I didn't like alligators. I didn't like 100% humidity, rain every day. And then, you know, everything was so slow down there, and I'm not slow. So, you know, the grocery store, they go, oh, milk, 49 cents, okay. And then, and I'm going, let me out of here. So, I gave notice and it said, thank you. And they said, would you be interested in coming out to Disneyland? Because we need maybe some fresh blood with the Disneyland Band. So that was a wonderful experience for me to do.
Okay, so you are in California. You are part of the Disneyland Band. And take me on a journey from that to the time that you retire, because you do a lot of other things besides leading that band while
right.
You're here.
I led the band up until 1982. Then in 1983, I went into talent booking and casting. And so that was kind of how I mutated through the administrative part of Disney and stayed that way until I retired, really, you know. So I've probably, they say, and I think it's right, I've hired more professional musicians than anybody in the world. Between Disney World and the different theme parks around the country where I'd go do auditions, and Disneyland. Which was great for me because my whole deal in life is to give live musicians a great chance to perform, you know, instead of dead ones. No, live, be able to expose the talent that is ours, in especially in Southern California. So that was neat.
Well, I'm going to try to get into Stan's mind for a little bit, if
good
that's
luck.
Okay.
Yeah, right. Be careful.
Because I want to know how you go into, how is the process that you go through to choose that right musician for the theme park? So what happens? I come in and I shouldn't admit this, but I play clarinet.
Why shouldn't you admit that?
Well, because I don't play it anymore.
Oh, okay.
Yes, yes.
So. Want to sell it? No. Okay.
Yeah. So you're so bad.
Thanks.
So I come in, but I'm a professional now. So I'm a clarinet player. I come in and audition for you. So what are you looking for?
Good question, because there's a lot of great players that don't want to work at Disneyland, which I can, well, they don't want to put a funny hat on, you know, a straw hat or whatever. And I'm totally with that. So it takes a person with a certain kind of personality in the first place that wants to go out there and be on the street and mix it up with the people. And so personality is really important, as important as anything else. And then somebody that can sight read, and then somebody that can play jazz, that can improvise. So those are pretty much the things.
And after the person gets the job, how do they keep the job? Because, I mean, it's one thing to audition and then you have a job and this is one of your dream jobs, but how do you keep it as a musician?
Well, because interesting. At Disneyland in California at that time, it was easier to get guys to stay on than it was in Florida, where it was 100 degrees and 100% humidity and rained every day with snakes and bugs. So those guys, a lot of them bailed the first year. So that left me having to find new musicians right off the bat. to go to Disney World and play in that band. So I went to Washington, D.C. and was looking for retired service band musicians because they were used to keeping the uniforms clean, their hair short, you know, and following orders. So that was cool. That worked out well. But I'll tell you an interesting story about that. So I'm looking for trumpet players. I get a call from a guy who says, hey, I'm a trumpet player. I live in Atlanta. And so-and-so recommended me, so he said, I'd like to come and audition for you in Orlando. I said, great. So we made it, he said, I'm gonna be staying at the YMCA. So I said, okay, cool, I'll pick you up from the Y the next morning. We'll drive down to Disney World. I'll have you perform with some of the guys and just see how you like it and how we like you. The guy says, great. So next day, I'm in my car, I'm driving to pick this guy up at the Y, and I hear on the news, itinerant trumpet player from Atlanta murders local Orlandian over a pool game at the Y. And I'm going, that's the guy, man. That is the guy.
Oh my God.
And I'd never forget, I made a U-turn right in the middle of the street and just headed back home and thought, what if I had hired him and I had said something to him that he didn't like? You know, I could have been a dead band leader. But that was an interesting one.
Very interesting, yeah. And it seems like you just got out.
With
your life in your hands.
Yeah.
Wow, okay. Well, we want to hear more stories about you and your background, about your book, and a little bit about what it means to raise two sons in the music business as well. So,
great.
So hang on.
All right.
We're going to turn it over and have our audience come back. So stay with us and come right back. We have more with Stan.
Smoking and thought, that's that. But here's the thing about lung cancer. By the time you see the symptoms, it could be too late. But now, there's a new scan that can detect lung cancer early when it's more curable. If you smoked, get scanned. Talk to your doctor or learn more at savedbythescan.org.
So Stan, I have some questions for you. And this first question is, what makes Stan unique?
Mickey Mouse tattoos on my butt? How does that go? That starts it. I've got some unusual tattoos in unusual places, just for fun. You know, it's like, I did the first one on a dare, and then in my sobriety, I'm in Alcoholics Anonymous, and so then every 5 years I'd get another one just to kind of celebrate my sobriety. And then this was Clint Eastwood, you know, Don't Let the Old Man In, and so Toby Keith and he were doing a shoot, and they were up, had to be up at 8 o'clock the next morning. And Toby Keith said, how do you do this? And Clint said, I just don't let the old man in. And that resonated with me, since I'm old. So I had that done here in Disney font. And then, a little bit later, I went to the doctor, and among other things, he said, you know what, you're pre-diabetic. You better cut back on the sugar. So I went, no spoonful of sugar, with her umbrella there. So every time I reach for that refrigerator, I look down there. So.
Have a reminder.
Yeah.
So your life has just become a lot of Disney around things that you do now.
Well, I did, for sure. And I still do. Yeah, I still do. I still work as a clinician out there.
And you talked a little bit about your sobriety. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about that because it leads into your book that you're working on. Mm-hmm. And so why did you think now's the time to write a book?
I was looking at the obituaries one Sunday, and I took and I averaged all the guys' ages that had passed away that week, just for something to do, me and my friends sitting around. And so I looked and I realized that I have a life expectancy of 24 hours. Looking at everybody there, and I'm 76, and I'm going, you know what, man? I better start having a little more fun, you know? So that's kind of how that all started.
So we thought by having more fun, we'd write a book.
Write a book. Yeah, that's right.
And in that first chapter is really interesting because you talk a little bit about your retirement party mm-hmm. at Disneyland.
Mm-hmm. It was great.
It was great. Why do you think that it made it so great? Was it because family was there, you were finally retiring, or was Stan now going to live a different chapter in his life?
I think all of those, to tell you the truth. Yeah, there were a lot of really good friends there, and they had a great show that they did that they put together with singers and dancers, All About My Life. And my sons were there, Josh and Jason, who were both musicians. And it was just a real meaningful afternoon for me. I was so fortunate that they did that, you know. I think it was just kind of glad that I'm finally leaving there, you know.
Well, you put a lot of wonderful years there, and actually, I would love to ask you today, because you actually gave a lot of musicians their starts in their careers. Is there any one musician that sticks out of your mind, except for the one we talked about earlier that, thank goodness, you didn't hire.
Right.
But any other ones that didn't commit crimes that we might want to talk about?
Yeah. You know what? Probably not. I can't think of one individual one. I know you had Sal Lozano on the
yes.
program. He was one that I started out, and he was just a little kid, you know, 18 or 19. But there's just been so many great musicians go through that park, men and women. Cindy Shea, who has the Mariachi Divas, which is an all-girl mariachi band, and she has gotten 2 Grammys with that mariachi band, and you should have her on the show.
Oh, matter
of fact,
wonderful.
Yeah, she's great. So I started that. I really kind of made it a mission to showcase women musicians because there's so many good ones, and I've had more girl band leaders out there than any other talent agent of any Disney parks. I've had, you know, a lot of Thomasina and Cindy Shea and Adelaide and, you know, I mean, they go on and on. Brooke Wilkes, a lot of girls. And I just figured, you know, fact is, with the one person she was Thomasina, her name is, who you should also have. And she was in a real great band, but they kind of kept her back. You know, the leader just kind of kept her, you know, and I went, this girl is really great. So I took her out to lunch. I said, hey, I would like to put a band around you. Would you be up for that? And so I kind of took her by surprise, but she thought, and she said, yeah, I'd really like that. And I said, okay, what should we name it? And she came up with some dumb ideas. And I said, no, let's call it Thomasina. It's a great name, you know, and just one name. And so that's what we did. And she's been one of the more successful bands we've ever had.
Wow, wow. And you mentioned your sons a few minutes ago. Sure. And they are also professional musicians uh-huh. too. So how did you feel as a father when you saw that that was the path that they both wanted to take?
Well, interesting, because I wasn't going to push either of them into the business. You know, I just thought it's a rough business. If they really want to do it, I'll be able to see that. I'm not going to come home and bring a saxophone and say, okay, go. So both of them, however, on their own, just started wanting to play instruments. And Josh, my son that plays with Sting, he was like 7 years old and he quit playing with toys, just sticks. And so I went, you know, now I believe in reincarnation. So he you know, from then on, that was it. Josh was it. And then he went with the Zappas when he was 14 or whatever. And Jason decided he wanted to be a woodwind player first, and then played keyboards and was out with Joe Walsh when he was just a kid playing keyboards, and then went with the Goo Goo Dolls, and then he's been with Green Day for the last 14 years as a keyboard player.
Wow.
So yeah, I'm the only father of two rock and roll musicians that don't support either one of them. You know? Yeah, can you believe that?
And that's a good goal to have.
Yeah, it was. Could have been way different.
Well, we have spent so much time with you today, and I appreciate your time with us tonight, but we can't let you go without talking a little bit about those shows that you were on, Hee Haw.
Oh. Yeah.
I waited until the very end to bring it up because it's so incredible. So when did you start getting on the shows? Were you already working for Walt Disney Company?
Oh, yeah.
So tell me how that process worked out.
I was ready to turn 40, and I realized I'd recorded on the tuba just about every genre of music that can be recorded on a tuba. You know, symphonic stuff, yeah. Dixieland stuff, concert band stuff, but I hadn't done any country. So I thought, oh man, I got like 3 months to write a country tune. What am I going to write about? So I wrote a song about a symphony tuba player that gets lost on the way to a gig with his tuxedo on and everything, and he stops into a redneck bar for directions. And rather than the old scenario where they would shoot and make the nerd tap dance, well, here they make him play country tuba in this bar. So it's called Play That Country Tuba Cowboy, which is the same time that the other song was out. Okay. Anyhow, so I wrote this song, and I had the guys at Disney, John Jorgensen, a bunch of really famous, now famous guys, do the soundtrack, and I took it in, played it for my boss. And the next day, and they said, hey, Sonny Anderson, I said, listen to this. I just wrote it. Well, he liked it so much, he said, I'm going to call my friend Sam Lovello. Sam Lovello is with Young Stream Production, had done Smothers Brothers show and the Jonathan Winters show, and now he was doing Hee Haw. And so he said, I'm going to go up and talk to him. Let's go up, take this song. I want you to play this song for Sam Lovello. So we went up there, and they finished their business, and then Sonny says, hey, Sam, I want you to hear this song. So Sam takes it. At that time, it was a cassette, and he put it in the machine, and he started to play this song. And as you know, country songs are all about telling a story. So he got about halfway through this song, and he stands up, which really irked me because I thought, hey, man, you have to listen to the story. So he comes to a big blackboard that is segmented into the months of the year, and he takes a piece of chalk while my song's going, and I'm going, come on, man, sit down. And he starts making X's. When the thing is over, he says, okay, I want you in Nashville this day, this day, this day, this day. And I said, really? He said, yeah, I want you on the show. I want you on Hee Haw. So he said, what kind of a tuba do you have? I said, well, it's a handmade German mirror phone, blah, blah. He said, no, I want you to get a beat up old silver sousaphone. So I said, okay. So I did that and went down to Nashville. My deal was with Hee Haw, I could be on as many times as I could write a funny song about the tuba. Roy Clark, who's a tuba player, and I would do these funny tunes. And so that's kind of how that whole thing happened.
Well, musician stories have made the rounds about traveling bands and honky-tonk towns, but for tuba players, this has got to be a first. Well, this one starts like they all do. I've been traveling hard for a day or two, and I stopped into this joint to quench my thirst. Well, up walked this big mountain man, said, what you got there, a garbage can? I said, excuse me, that's my tuba, if you please. Well, he said, great, play a country song so me and my buddies can sing along. And I told him, I only play with symphonies. Wrong. Well, he slammed his fist and spit out his beer, and his body language made it very clear this wasn't going to be just another B-flat day. That's when he cocked his 30-06, and man, I let out with some country licks. I never thought I'd hear this tuba play.
Play the country tuba, cowboy. Play the country tuba, cowboy. Play the country tuba, play the country tuba.
Nashville, crazy, fun. And that they would shoot every 6 months. Some six-month periods I wouldn't be on at all because I wouldn't have time to write a funny song about the tuba. So.
Wow. So if I wanted to find all of these funny songs about the tuba, do you think that they're out there right now?
You know what? I know some of them are on YouTube. You know, I know that Play That Country Tuba Cowboy is on there. And then I've got You Ain't Live Till You Kiss the Tuba Player, and, you know, Minnie Pearl and the Old Girl Tuba Marching Band. There's a bunch of them that are on, and I imagine there's a bunch that aren't. I don't follow myself too closely.
Oh my goodness. Well, you should, because you are absolutely amazing, and I appreciate the time that you've taken today to tell us all these wonderful stories.
My pleasure too.
Before we end, because you have started so many wonderful careers out there, can you give us just one piece of advice for someone who wants to become a musician right now in 2021?
Don't drink. No. let's see. To become a professional musician?
Yes.
I would just say that no matter what, you do what's in your heart. You totally don't let anybody tell you it can't be done, because they would have told me that picking up a sousaphone, you know. I mean, that would have been the first thing they told me. So just do what's in your heart, and don't stop for nothing.
I love that, and that's the best way to end the show until you come back after your book is published.
Okay, great.
Promise you come back.
Yeah,
definitely.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
Thank you. And thank you so much for everything you've done just to keep millions of people entertained at our favorite amusement park. Yeah, and I cannot wait to read your book when it comes out.
Oh, good.
Thank you. And thank you for joining us on Everybody with Angela Williamson. Viewers like you make this show possible. Stay in touch with us on social media. Good night and stay well.
Well, after a while, I ran out of air and I figured I better get out of there. So I grabbed my tuba and I headed for the door. Well, just about then, I felt a big lasso wrapped around me and my tuba too. And they yanked me back and they hollered, "More, man, more, yo." Hey.